Across the country and here in Massachusetts, we're hitting major milestones when it comes to vaccines. With more than 70% of people in the state 16 or over now at least partially inoculated, almost 60% of everyone here. And to get that number even higher, today Governor Baker announced some vaccine sites will begin accepting walk-up appointments starting next week.
Now that vaccines are becoming more widely available, we're shifting our efforts to focus on more targeted community-based outreach.
Nationally, more than 55% have gotten at least one dose. And yesterday, Biden set a goal to make that 70% by July 4th.
Get vaccinated. In 2 months, let's celebrate our independence as a nation and our independence from this virus.
Today, Biden's team also came out in support of waiving patent protections on the U.S.-made COVID vaccines so other countries can start manufacturing them, get more shots and arms around the world more quickly. But it's not all good news. Some are seeing the president's 70% goal as a step down from efforts to reach herd immunity when the virus just stops circulating. And public health experts are now warning it's unlikely we'll ever get rid of COVID altogether.
We may not get to zero, we probably won't, but if we can get the infections under at very low levels, most of us can get back to our lives in normal ways, I think we can probably live with that.
And so far, it's looking like it'll be easier to live with it in some places than others, as a sharp divide emerges between red states and blue. With the top five states when it comes to vaccination rates, including this one, all going for Biden in the last election, the bottom five all for Trump. Some cities and states are offering incentives for people to get their shots. $50 in Detroit, $100 in Maryland, a free beer in New Jersey. Really? That's why today, White House Senior Advisor for COVID Response, Sandy Slavitt, urged those who are vaccinated to help get people around them on board.
This is your call to action. People want to know what your experience was like. So please talk with your friends, family, neighbors, and community. Share why you chose to get vaccinated, what it was like to get one, and how it felt when you finally got the vaccine.
I'm joined by Dr. Cassandra Pierre, acting hospital epidemiologist and medical director of public health programs at Boston Medical Center, Dr. Michael Minna, an assistant professor of epidemiology at Harvard School of Public Health, and an associate medical director in the Department of Pathology at Brigham and Women's. Dr. Minna, good to meet you. Dr. Pierre, good to see you again.
Lovely to be here.
Dr. Pierre, if I can start with you. For months, we heard herd immunity was the promised land, and then just like that, the possibility disappeared. I assume it was a casualty of a couple of things: vaccine hesitancy and the fact that variants, which are more transmissible, sort of up that threshold. Am I right about that?
It's a casualty of those things. Absolutely. It's a casualty of not having enough global vaccine access, local vaccine access, and not understanding the mechanisms of delivering vaccines to structurally underserved areas. But yes, there are. This is multifactorial, and we've said for a little bit that this might be more of a marathon than a sprint, and that indeed seems to be the case.
So, Dr. Minna, what replaces herd immunity? We keep encouraging people to get vaccinated as much as possible, and then is the hope that it becomes seasonal flu-like, where we get a booster, and so it lingers, but at a manageable rate. Is that the hope?
That's right. I mean, the general hope is that we get as many of the most vulnerable people vaccinated. Herd immunity is on a continuum. Every vaccine that goes into somebody's arm is towards what we call a herd immunity threshold. But that is really defined as the threshold at which a new virus just really can't transmit across and sustain itself across the population. But it didn't mean that infections were never going to be able to occur anymore. And so this is also on the continuum of learning how to deal with this pandemic and ideally being able to protect the most vulnerable and then dealing with the additional cases that might occur that aren't going to hopefully lead to hospitalizations and deaths.
Obviously, there's a consensus, regardless, herd immunity or not, more vaccinations is the goal. Dr. Minna, staying with you, are you a carrot or a stick kind of person? Should we have mandates, or we just create more incentives that convince people this is the right thing to do?
Well, I'm personally always for incentives if we can do that. I don't think, especially in our largely divided country today, that really creating penalties, for example, as a result of not getting vaccinated is going to be tolerated in much of the country. I think we need to incentivize to educate people as much as possible and make sure and use all of the resources we have. We should be educating the population in ways that we haven't yet, getting the best agencies to put ads on TV to really start tackling social media feeds and with good information across the country.
By the way, surveys show, Doctor, and I know you know this, that money works. I wasn't being facetious a couple of minutes ago. It increases the likelihood of somebody getting a shot who otherwise would not pretty dramatically. Dr. Pierre, Governor Baker announced that he's closing four of the seven mass vaccination sites. Even though our numbers are really high, it appears he's convinced that going local for the next round of this is the only way to go. That is the best way to go. Is it not for the next phase?
I think people have been saying for a little bit that, yes, for the next wave, especially for vaccinating individuals who are younger, healthier, may have had less connection with trusted advisors or may have a sense of invincibility, that going local will be necessary, that we will need to bring vaccines to the people rather than expecting them to show to the mass vaccination sites. I think that strategy of thinking locally might also serve us well when we're thinking about getting to higher rates of vaccination. You know, we need to, not just medical professionals or public health providers, think about having, just as it was said in the clip, having people talk to their churches, their prayer groups, their bartenders, the people that do their hair, and share experiences to hopefully fill in some of the vacuum, give people some information that they have not been getting, and hopefully weigh out misinformation and missing facts so that people can...
Pierre, at the top, I mentioned the announcement by the Biden administration today. They're going to work towards waiving these patent protections, which obviously is good news for under-vaccinated countries. But as of today, everybody knows the numbers. India, roughly 2%. South Africa, roughly 1%, while the United States is approaching 50%. Here in Massachusetts, we're almost at 60%, while places, I think Mississippi, is at 31%. So, Dr. Pierre, we know what the implications of those kinds of numbers are for the low vaccinated states and countries. What are the implications for a place like Massachusetts to be have other states in our country with low vaccination rates and places like India, for example, with what, a billion people having minuscule vaccination rates? What's the impact on us?
So, you know, we want everyone as much as possible to be well vaccinated, but thinking from a kind of more nativist perspective, the higher our vaccination rates, the less outbreaks we will be seeing. We know that we are not an island, and I don't mean to suggest that, but having better vaccination rates in general will hopefully bring down all those hospitalizations, the long-term consequences that we've seen with COVID-19 and people who have them. But yes, it is also important to ensure as much as possible that our neighbors are getting good information and vaccines, that people in India, Brazil, sub-Saharan Africa are at least just starting a vaccine rollout process to avoid these terrible scenes that we've been seeing, because the variants of concern do circulate in areas, in locations where there are high levels of transmission. So the more variants that come about with more virulence, with more ability to evade vaccine-related immunity, we will unfortunately inevitably be seeing those variants of concern show up on our doorsteps. So both things are important.
Dr. Mann, I know we can't be one-trick ponies in this also. I've read some of your tweets where you talk about the importance, I hope I get this right, you'll correct me if I'm wrong, of these at-home tests that are finally, after we've been talking about this for a year, available. Why are they so important, and how do we use them most effectively in this war?
Yeah, it's a great question. The reason that they were so incredibly important last year, for example, is because the virus spreads largely because people don't know that they are transmitting it when they transmit to others. So testing in a pandemic like this is our eyes. If we test frequently, we would be able to know when we're infected, when we're transmissible, and these rapid tests are very good at identifying that within just a matter of minutes, could be done at home. We're in a new phase of the pandemic now Many Americans, as we're talking about, are vaccinated, but many are not. And we still need to have eyes on this virus. We still need to know if we're going into a nursing home, if we're going into a school that's unvaccinated, any number of places, we still are better off knowing if we are carrying the virus, and we might want to change our behavior accordingly, if so. And that's where easy, ready access to fast, inexpensive, ideally, at-home testing would be crucial.
Well, ideally, the feds would start paying for this. I only have a minute left, and I hope this is not going to backfire on me, but since we were all talking about incentives, starting with you, Dr. Pierre, quickly, what are you doing now that you were unwilling to do when you're unvaccinated?
Travel, mm-hmm. Hug my in-laws, and also have them babysit.
Oh, that's pretty great. And Dr. Mina, how about you?
Yeah, likewise, travel. I'm actually going to, I have very rarely left my house, in fact, this past year, mostly because of work, but also because of not being vaccinated and having large numbers of cases around. And certainly I feel much more free in many ways to be able to travel safely, especially when I am then coming home to others who might not be vaccinated.
Yeah, I'd put hugging at the top of that list myself. Dr. Pierre, Dr. Mina, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate you both.
Thank you.